In this video, we're going to be looking at John Keats. And in the interest of full disclosure, I have to say that he's probably my favorite poet, certainly one of my favorite poets. When talking about Keats, it's too easy to focus on the many tragedies of his short life and look at it as an example of sadness. And indeed, there are many reasons to consider the tragedies of his short life. His father died when he was a child, his mother more or less abandoned him, which actually worked out to his advantage. Then his mother died. His guardian took him out of school, which he enjoyed, and apprenticed him to a surgeon apothecary, a job which he hated and which he abandoned as soon as he legally could. His brother died of tuberculosis in his arms. His mother had also died of tuberculosis. His other brother had a difficult life in America, where he had immigrated on a poorly conceived scheme. He was engaged to a young woman with whom he was passionately in love, but whom he was never able to marry because his career as a poet and his failing health made it impossible for them to marry. And in fact, there's a recent movie called Bright Star, which looks at their relationship. And then, of course, he died at the age of 26 of tuberculosis. And so there are a lot of reasons for one to look at his life as an example of sustained unhappiness. But I prefer not to look at it that way, because Keats himself seems to be someone who pushed through his troubles and tragedies and became quite successful. I think the greatest tragedy was that Keats died so young, at 26, because he took on himself the role of being a professional poet, and he took his job of being a professional poet very seriously and worked and studied in order to improve his poetry. And at the age of 26, he was only improving as a poet. Unlike Wordsworth, who by the age of 26 had written most of his great poetry and was sort of on a downhill trend, Keats was improving. And the biggest tragedy is what Keats might have done had he been able to sustain his poetic development. Nevertheless, during his brief life, and especially during the famous summer of 1819, during which he composed all of his great odes and many other very wonderful poems, one of the things I think that we should take away from it was his amazing accomplishments. Even though he died at the age of 26, he remains one of England's great poets, and one whose poetry has only increased in appreciation since his death. It's also important to keep in mind that Keats himself seems to have been a very likable person who attracted other people to him, and we get an opportunity to read his letters and encounter his personality. So not only was he a great poet, but he also seems to have been a genuinely good person. The other thing I want to call to your attention about Keats is that he was born in 1795, and his birth helps point out the artificiality of the distinction between Romantic and Victorian periods, because Thomas Carlyle and John Keats were both born in the same year. Thomas Carlyle lived to be a ripe old age and therefore became a great Victorian. John Keats died young and therefore was a great Romantic poet. Had their roles been reversed, however, Keats would have been a great Victorian poet, and Thomas Carlyle would be unknown, because he really didn't start his writing career until a more advanced age, and had he died at 26, we would not know who he was. But nevertheless, he would have been considered a romantic. And when one looks at Carlyle's writings, it's easy to see the romantic impulse behind Carlyle, who nevertheless became one of the most influential writers of the 19th century. So we will be looking first at Keats' letters, and then using Keats' letters to understand Keats' poetry. Keats, unlike Wordsworth or Coleridge, did not sit down and write out a poetic manifesto, deliberately laying out his poetic enterprise or his goals. Nevertheless, by reading his letters, we can see that he did have a well-considered, self-conscious poetic goal and a theory of poetry that guides his work and is exemplified in his work. And so by going through his letters, we can pull out his discussions with his friends about poetry, the nature and purpose of poetry, and better understand what he was trying to accomplish. Before we start looking at the letters or the poetry, it's important that we look at a concept which is essential to understanding Keats' poetry and also Shelley's poetry as well, and which we'll see exemplified both in his defense of poetry and also in his poem Mont Blanc. That's the idea of Neoplatonism, which underlies their assumptions about the nature of the world and drives their poetry. As Sir Philip Sidney said several hundred years before, nature gives us only a brazen world while the poets deliver a golden. And that underlies the idea behind Keats' Ode on a Grecian Urn, for example. And we'll see it exemplified there. So in order to understand Neoplatonism, first we need to know something about its origins, especially the idea developed by the Greek philosopher Plato, who was writing in the first century before the Christian era, and is often regarded as the founder of Western philosophy, student of Socrates, the teacher of Aristotle, who wrote the Socratic dialogues, the Symposium, the Crito, the Phaedrus. The Socratic dialogues exemplify what has become known as the Socratic method, by which, in Plato's representation, Socrates would have conversations with his friends, and through the process of rational elimination would define a concept like justice or love to get to the essential ideas. He would ask his friends questions about what the concept meant to them, and they would respond in a variety of ways. And then he would gradually, through a series of questions, weed out all of the extraneous or accidental associations until you got to the essence of the concept itself. And that's what the basis of the Socratic dialogue was. The concepts he was able to reach through this process of elimination reflected what Plato believed constituted the real. And we describe that through the term philosophical or Platonic realism. Now, it's important to understand what that means, because when we use realism in our contemporary world, or when we look at realism as it's represented in, say, the Victorian novel, we get a sense of the author's attempt to represent gritty day-to-day reality, the world as it really is, and often that world as it really is tainted by a sense of pessimism. And that notion of realism is an attempt to represent the day-to-day lived reality of experience. In the sense in the Victorian novels is that if you could actually go to these places and see these things happening, and even when it's not something realistic like the creation of Frankenstein's monster, there's nevertheless an attempt to explain it away scientifically. Mary Shelley explains Frankenstein's monster as a scientific process that produced this monster, and that this scientific process could be replicated were we only to know the secrets. Contemporary ideas of realism is based upon lived day-to-day experience. Philosophical realism, on the other hand, believes that the world around us is not the real world. And we'll be looking at how this works. In order to understand Plato's concept of reality, one needs to understand the relationship between the actual experiential world and what Plato thinks of as reality. The world in which we live, the world we experience through our senses, is the actual world, but it's not the real world. Now, that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Plato's not crazy. He understands that this world around us exists. But he distinguishes that from what he thinks of as the real world. And the world he thinks of as the real world is what we would think of as the ideal world. It is the realm of the good, the true, and the beautiful, as he describes it. And this is the world where real things exist in their purest form. Now, the real is accessible not through the senses for Plato, but only through the exercise of the reason. the reason is able to take us past the accidental assumptions of experience and to take us to the pure concepts of truth so that we can see these things in their absolute purity. So, for example, if you were to look at a tree, you're seeing only one particular tree. And so you could be looking at an oak or a sycamore or an elm or an alder tree. And all of these trees are very different, but nevertheless, what unifies them is this concept of tree, what modern semioticians would call the signified. And the process of reason is that one studies trees and gets to the essence of tree by eliminating all of those things which are accidental to the concept, that don't constitute its essence. So you'd look at palm trees, for instance, and oak trees, which look very different, and pepper trees. All of those things are very different, and you would exclude the things that make those things individual species specimens and try to get to the essence of the species. And that's how the Socratic method works, excluding accidentals till you get to the essence. And that essence, that enduring tree, that enduring concept of tree, is the real tree for Plato. Now, the problem for Plato is that we get caught up too much in the actual. And in Plato's Republic, he excludes artists. He does not allow artists in his republic. He allows certain kinds of martial music and certain kinds of practical art, but for the most part, he eliminates artists. And the reason he eliminates artists is actually quite simple. Artists celebrate the physical. They celebrate the actual. They celebrate the experiential. So if the actual tree is not the real tree, what is an artist painting? So the problem is, we have an artist who sees the actual world and then represents that actual world in his art. But that art is attractive. We enjoy the art. And so what it does is it actually takes us away from the real. And the art itself is, it's a copy of a copy, a poor representation of reality, because at least the actual reality is three-dimensional and we can walk around it and we can see it from all different sides. Representational art is only two-dimensional, or it's made out of stone. It's not even an accurate representation of the actual, much less a representation of the real. So it not only excludes the real and excludes the rational pursuit of the real, but actually discourages us from pursuing an understanding of the real. All right, so Plato bans artists from his republic because they distract us from our pursuit of the knowledge of things, the true knowledge of things, the essence. However, Neoplatonic art takes a different approach to this. Neoplatonic art, celebrated by philosophers such as Plotinus, see art in a different way. Neoplatonism suggests new Platonism, a new take on Platonism. So for the Neoplatonic philosopher, the artist isn't representing the real or the actual. For the Neoplatonic artist, the artist isn't representing the actual, but rather the artist is representing the real directly. The artist has a special get out of jail free card. So they're able to leap over the actual and represent the conceptualized true real. For a Neoplatonic theorist, art gives us truth. So that brings us to Keats' poetic theory and the ideas behind his practice of poetry, which we'll see by looking at his letters. We will begin by looking at page 1017 of the Norton Anthology, and specifically at his letter to his friend John Hamilton Reynolds on Wordsworth's poetry, dated February 3rd, 1818. In this letter, he begins to address the problem that he will discuss in another letter about poetry which focuses too much on the interests of the poet. He says, "Every man has his speculations, but every man does not brood and peacock over them until he makes a false coinage and deceives himself. Many a man can travel to the very bourne of heaven, and yet what confidence to put down his half-seeing? Sancho will invent a journey heavenward as well as anybody." Sancho Panza from Don Quixote.
We hate poetry that has a palpable design on us, and if we do not agree, seems to put its hand in its breeches pocket. Poetry should be great and unobtrusive, a thing which enters into one's soul and does not startle it or amaze it with itself, but with its subject. How beautiful are the retired flowers! How would they lose their beauty were they to throng into the highway crying out, "Admire me, I am a violet. Dote upon me, I am a primrose." One of the things he's suggesting here is that poetry should not be pushing an agenda. Poetry that has a palpable design upon us, and if you don't agree with that agenda, seems to look at you judgmentally. I love the idea of poetry leaning against a wall with his hand in its pants pocket looking at you judgmentally. Poetry should be great and unobtrusive, a thing which enters one's soul and does not startle it, amaze it with itself, but with its subject. So it's focusing not on the poetry or not on the poet, but on the object of the poetry. So retired flowers are beautiful. Flowers that come walking out to say, "Admire me, I am a primrose," are obnoxious and annoying. Let's scroll down and look at another place where he addresses a similar topic on page 1021 in his letter to Richard Woodhouse. He says, "As to the poetical character itself, I mean that sort of which, if I am anything, I am a member, that is, that sort distinguished from the very words worthing or egotistical sublime, which is a thing per se and stands alone, it is not itself. It has no self. It is everything and nothing. It has no character. It enjoys light and shade. It lives in gusto, be it foul or fair, high or low, rich or poor, mean or elevated. It has as much delight in conceiving it as an Iago as an Imogen. What shocks the virtuous philosopher delights the chameleon poet." And then he goes on to say, "A poet is the most unpoetical thing of anything in existence because he has no identity. He is continually in for and filling some other body. The sun, the moon, the sea, and men and women who are creatures of impulse are poetical and have about them an unchangeable attribute. The poet has none, no identity. He is certainly the most unpoetical of all God's creatures." Okay, so what does he mean by that? What does he mean by first saying a poet has no self? And he distinguishes the kind of poet he is from the poet that he calls the Wordsworthian or egotistical sublime. You will recall that when we talked about Wordsworth, we talked about the fact that Wordsworth's poetry most often focuses upon Wordsworth himself. He's walking down a lane through the country and he sees a young woman reaping wheat, and he composes The Solitary Reaper, which is how he feels when he hears her song. He sees an old man raking for leeches in a pool, and he thinks about how seeing this old man makes him feel better. So Wordsworth's poetry is most often about how Wordsworth feels. And to Keats, that's the opposite of what poetry should be about. It should not follow the egotistical sublime, but rather the poet has no self. And he opposes, in opposition to the egotistical sublime, this idea of the chameleon poet. And of course, this is how he spells it, but we would spell it a different way. But a chameleon, as you know, is a lizard that changes its color to match its environment, to blend into its environment. So the ideal poet is someone who has no identity, who focuses not on the poet self, but on the poetic object itself. So he has no identity. He is continually putting himself into some other body. The poet has none, no identity. So obviously he has an identity, but the ideal he's offering is that he dispenses with or buries his own identity in favor of investing himself into the poetic object and presenting us the poetic object directly. So how does he accomplish this? According to Keats, if we scroll back up to the bottom of page 1016, to a letter to George and Thomas Keats, his brothers, he explains this notion. He says, starting right here, "I had not a dispute, but a disquisition with Dilke on various subjects. Several things dovetailed in my mind. And it once struck me, What quality went to form a man of achievement, especially in literature, and which Shakespeare possessed so enormously? I mean, negative capability. That is, when a man is capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, doubts, without any irritable reaching after fact and reason. Coleridge, for instance, would let go by a fine, isolated verisimilitude caught from the very penetralium of mystery, from being incapable of remaining content with half-knowledge. So what does this term negative capability mean? And how is it related to this notion of the poet who has no self, who is a chameleon poet? When he explains he's capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, doubts, without any irritable reaching after fact and reason, what he means is that the poet's job is not to resolve mysteries. He's not, in this case, a philosopher. His job is not to solve the problems, but rather to present the problems or present the paradoxes to us directly. He's not supposed to fix the things. He's supposed to show us those things, show us the complexities, paradoxes, and conflicts of real life. And we'll see this very specifically in Ode to a Nightingale and Ode on a Grecian Urn when we look at them later. So the chameleon poet who has no self presents us with the world he sees, presents it to us in as unmediated a way as possible, without trying to solve the problems, but rather representing the world as he finds it. Now we'll see, when we look at the poems, that this is an ideal. And by an ideal, it's something that's very difficult, if not impossible, to reach. But it's an ideal for which Keats will strive in his poetry, as he attempts to ignore his own concerns as an individual human being, and rather present us with the universal world of art through poetry.